Okay. So, I'm back. Hope you are feeling good. So, yeah. So, we are talking about different web services styles. I mean, now we know what the web service is. Don't worry, I'm not going to ask you about web service again. So, what are styles? You know, styles are always styles. So, you have different web services styles. Like, there is one in which you work with wizards that you talked about, right? Wizards are nothing but gestures for the web services. Gestures, what operation it does and what parameters it takes. That's what the wizard is. Nothing else, nothing more than that. But there are easier forms of, easier styles of web services as well, where you don't have to bother about wizards. You just, those APIs from Facebook, Twitter and all. They are called RESTful web services. So I'll talk about that. So web services is basically a method of communication, right? We are not talking, doing anything else. We are just doing client-server model. We are not doing anything else. We have our code somewhere. We want to use it. We give our input to that. We get the output back. We use it. Fine. We do nothing else. So for that, we come across how our data very understand platform, independent thing we have some subject, how we will put all the frameworks together, right? So there we have different styles of web services, different data formats, different styles. So when you talk about this thing, we pass the input and we get back the result. Basically message passing, isn't it? It's message passing, right? So yeah. Things are coming slowly. So it's basically called soap. Soap is not the baking soap. It's a format, it's a style of developing web services and invoking it. So where we do basically message passing. So as you can see, the So message passing, we can pass arguments. You are calling in method, right? You pass arguments. Add, int, a, and b, you pass arguments. A and b, then and b, they are arguments, right? How do you pass arguments over the web? How do you pass arguments over the web? That can be understood by the other machine. So that's message passing, right? Or what do you do? What you want to do is that you want to update a student database with a new student web account. Right? So student is not an argument, right? It's a big thing, it's an object. As I showed you in the SML, student is something like the name, it has a role, it has actors again has a lot of inside things. State, country, house number, date of birth, other things are there. So that's an object. How do you pass an object as an argument? Or how do you pass individual arguments like A and B or whatever? A, you want to know whether today is a leap year or not. This year is a leap year or not. You are just passing one value. And he is also giving you one value. Leap year, not leap year, right? So that's arguments. So these are the two styles of message passing that we use in SOAP. So first one is, the first one you can say is the RPC style, which basically you pass parameters, right? You pass parameters. So RPC, the full form stands for, anybody know the full form of RPC? Yeah, you know, procedure calls. So where you call a method on another machine, some code is there on another machine, you call it basically, right? So this whole system is actually developed from their way, and still we do RPC in the inner, I mean, in the bottom layer, it's basically RPC only, but in the top, we have abstracted it so much that it feels very easy to use and has to have other stuff there. So there are two types of message passing, right? The first one is passing through some parameter, and the second is document style, where you pass the whole XML. You represent an entity or object using an XML representation, like you did with the student representation, and you pass that through, right? So in any case, how it goes? We pass an argument, we pass a string, we know, fine. How it goes there? How it understands it? Okay. So we'll see that in the next slide. The next one is, the first one was message passing. The second one is manipulating web resources. Can it do a simpler form? We have something on the web, right? Every web page is a web resource. How many of you agree to this point? What is a web resource? Yeah, anybody? Web resource. What is the resource? What is the resource? Anybody? Yes, from that side? What is the resource? Anything that is useful. That's the resource. What's the word resource? That's all the web. Right? How do you access? How do you access gmail.com? You type www.gmail.com. Right? Web resource, it should have something to identify it. That's called URI. Uniform resource identifier. Right? So every web page is a web resource. So can't you do something similar? Can't you make a web service as a web resource? We don't have to call it, we don't have to do anything. We just type it there. Like what we showed, right? That XML that returns the student's details. That's so that was a web resource and that's also a web service. Right? A web service that can return you an XML type of thing, which behaves like a web service. It's a resource that is a web service as well. So these are two types. What is basically message passing? You do the web service, so you pass message and you get that done. The other one is you don't move it. It's there on the web, you just invoke it. You just invoke it and it turns you back the results. So let's go on to the message passing thing first, right? So it's called SOAP. That is saying it's not a bathing soap. it stands for Simple Object Access Protocol, where it deals with object concepts. Means it passes, it's basically used for passing the objects and in a format that this guy will understand and again it comes back and this guy will again understand what the result is, right? So the second one that I talked about, manipulating web resources, is called REST. Very much at ease because it's very cool and very easy to understand. So my friend has been talked about REST, so let me actually tell you about what it's through. So it's a protocol, it's W3C standard, where W3C is one wide web consortium. So how do we use SOAP? Let us see. Message format, it uses an XML, right? It uses XML to send message and return back message. Remember, it's a message passing. So, yeah, it works over HTTP. It can work over other application layers protocol also. You can design it, but currently most of the SOAP versions that are there, they work over HTTP. So, now, let me make it a little bit interesting. What is the SOAP? As this guy is always talking about SOAP, XML, but we don't know what SOAP is like, right? So, have you sent letters in your childhood? We used to send inline letters, right? Inline letters, we used to write address to this, and we used to write that header thing that is from this part, and inside we write the message, paste it, send it there. Right, in that letter. So SOAP is something like that. There is an envelope. There is an envelope where it is written the header. So header is basically certain information like some security aspects and all. And then there is a body where you actually put the data that you want to transfer. Right? So this is basically SOAP that is used for transferring the inputs also and returning back the results as well. Okay. So let us see how a SOAP is created. This is used for SOAP services, right? So on the left side you can see the more familiar student representation of our one row of a student. The name is Kiran and it's a representation in XML, right? So how this goes as a SOAP message to our web servers? This goes something like this. So the red part you see, they are part of SOAP envelope and the actual data that goes inside the body. So remember SOAP has two parts, SOAP header and SOAP body. Header that we need to act, put into. For example, if you don't want your service to be used by everybody, you only want it to be used by certain people with certain credentials, username and password, right? So you will put those username and password inside your header. And your server should know that if the header contains this user ID and password and use these tokens, then only I can access it. Otherwise, I will return that it is invalid. Right? So those are useful headers. So mainly coming from the body part, that my XML was put into here, and then this whole thing, right? This whole thing was put into HTTP POST. When my friend talked about submitting a form, right? You write an email or you submit your student record from your website and hit submit. So it does a HTTP POST request. So HTTP is the protocol where the whole worldwide web, the whole web pages and other things are running, right? So there you can either do a GET when you write something like flickr.com/photo/ your name, Kiran, this is the account name, and slash some photo record number, you get a picture back. So that's a GET. And when you want to add certain things to the server, you do a POST. So that's a HTTP POST. So when you actually send this message to the server, to the web service, you do a POST. So this POST will get another goal here, right? The SOAP framework takes care. It takes care of returning, stripping that this part and giving it the actual method that is handling it. So my friends will actually show you how, which method is getting handled and all. So this is the actual SOAP thing. So and it also returns back the same angle. When it returns back, it will also return the same thing. Just that now inside the body, you have the student data, which is the input. When it returns back, it will again be the same angle. But when it returns back, it will be the result. Correct now? Okay. So. So it's more or less the same, and I won't go into this, but still I think my friend has already talked about. So let me do a quick recap. So let me do a quick recap of what we did. We talked about different service types, basically two types. The first one was message passing, right? Which we used to there. Simple object access protocol, where you send a representation in an XML of our data layer. I can pass parameters. If you pass parameters, it will again use a scope in the scope body, and within which if you are passing A and B, it will be A and then B. These two things will go there, right? And when it returns, it will again use a same scope in the other, and inside it will be a result and the summation. So it is the same. So message passing via web service is done by this scope and color, right? The other component is we represent our service as a web resource. And we tell you that, okay, I want to invoke a GET method on it. So it will return you some results. If you do a post, it will update itself. So my friend has been talking about that. So in this source and message passing, there are many questions. This guy is asking.
So only use an XML because so can never return, it is written in the XML format. So you only use an XML, and with your XML, as I said, that you can submit your definition. So that the server will also understand that this part of the store is this part of your body, this is the name, this is the this is of the skin, this is your age, this is the interior. So it's basically it.
So, yeah, thank you. Over to Neil. We'll tell you about web services as resources.
I said something to you that there are two kind of register in this training style, one is rope and the rest. I personally like the rest one, that's what I decided to take for newest and they call it wash rituals, wash floor with soap and mineral dye and take rest. So basically rest is easy, that's the moral. Rest is not a standard, it's an architectural style. Using which the rest surfaces are developed. So rest application are architectural style to service that utilize web standards like URI, HTTP, CMF, XML, Atom, RDF. These are web standards. REST itself is not web standard, it's a style. You can deviate from it, you don't have to really hard and fast, there's no hard and fast rule that you stick to REST. But it's a style of creating web service. You will know what is actually needed. Resource. Master talk about resource. Resource is any object, anything lying on the web. It may be a photo lying on the server, maybe a customer information lying on the server, or it may be a name which is lying on the server and you want to access it. So, in REST, we give everything an ID so that we can mention in the URL what is that you want. Because we cannot specify in the URL that this is something good. This is not an ID. This is really an invalid statement, which is better than what. So, for REST, you have to assign a particular ID to the object required access. And this ID you have to mention to the URL so the server can understand what exactly you want. So, client communicate with resources via request using a standard set of methods. As I come to that, what methods we're talking about? A request and response generate resource representation in format identified by media types. So, while requesting a REST type of service, you specify you want XML or you want JSON, you want plain text. What is the format you want? And server will obey your order and serve you as required. And when the server gives you resource, when the server gives you particular response, it contains further URL so that you can navigate further. So I will come to example of each of them. Let's go one by one. This is a particular URL. It's a superset of URL. Universal resource resources, okay? These are examples of your example.com/widgets/2. So you want a widget called 2. So you have given a name to that widget. The server will not be confused at what you want. Server knows you want 2 and will serve you 2. So there are examples, the customer example, terminal. You have all the customer information in a server called example.com and you are asking customer ID 2. You assign an ID to each and every customer and you are asking, you give me the information about the customer 2. The 2 is mentioned in the requirement itself. So all the requests in the REST tag is the truth, the command itself lies in the URL itself. From the URL, you can easily identify anything you want in the server. So as I said, REST is not standard. Do not find somewhere telling you REST community from IBM or Microsoft. It's a rather a design pattern, and you can bottle up the pattern. You can always use the pattern, you can follow the pattern, you follow the pattern to the extent it's possible, and to the extent it's required. So along with the URL, you need to tell what method means. So just by URL you are locating the customer, but you don't know you are trying to get the customer or update the customer information to the server, or you want to add a new customer to the server. See the last example. Here you are trying to access a customer URL, but you don't know you are adding a customer, you are deleting a customer, or you are updating a customer information. These four methods. One of these four methods are always accompanied with a URL I mentioned earlier. If it's a get method, then give me some information about the customer who is a part of the URL. If it is a post method, then here is an update about the customer name was Apple Computers, not the customer name changed to Apple Incorporated, so change it. So update some information you use post. Put splicing it, inserting a new information in the customer base. For example, you have a database in the server which needs to be inserted with the values of a newly acquired customer. You use put. And give this particular URL, it should be a new URL because the existing URL will be a conflict with the customer there. You give a new URL and give a put operation. And along with the put operation, you have to give some set of data, the new customer data, so that the server accepts the data and inserts in the database. Once you have put, you can get the same thing very well. Delete for deleting a customer from the database. Let's use hope, the header, body, what password you want to call. And the rest looks like simply this. So which one is easier? According to you. Rest? Yes, this is simple. One line. So anyway, both soap and rest have their advantages and advantages. But I personally like rest because of the simplicity. And when you are giving a URL with a method, the data can be sent either using XML or JSON or XHTML, the width, hard and fast HTML. Then you have to close the tags and VRCP, having it close the flash. And every REST request, there is something called accept header that gives you information whether you want to get the data in JSON or XML. I'll give you an example. And the principle of REST communication are stateless. These identify won't change. Whenever you next service today or tomorrow, the identifier doesn't change. And it doesn't have any sessions. When you log into Gmail, and you might have noticed for each and every email, you have separate URL in the bar. And next day you come and you bookmark that URL. Okay. Next day you come over and access that same URL, but you forgot your password, that is not open. Because Gmail maintains a session in your browser to know that you are a valid user who has logged in using a valid username and password. Unlike that, REST, everything is in the URL. If you have the correct URL, if you have the correct method name and the correct data, it will give you a response. There is nothing called state that is maintained over a period to authenticate you or to serve you and get your information. That's the end of REST. So I will show you a sample REST application for the URL. I told you about URL.
I just want to get information about the first one. Okay.
experience over there. I just got the data on the first one. Similarly, in the state of water, I got another person's data. So, breast service is all about the UR unique, the UR construction using the unique identifier, and it is all about instead of having operations in the server, it's all about representing everything as an entity. And you change or delete or add new entity in the server using the URL itself. And all these operations can be done with a fixed set of methods like post, get, put, and delete, what I've discussed. So basically, REST style ensures you that everything is mapped to a URL and identifier. And by the way, I forgot to tell you the full form of the REST. It's representational state transfer. Representational state transfer and for the philosophy that everything in the server has a URL, you present it in the URL and the stateless. You change the state using the standard set of methods get, put, and delete.
Listening to it is a boring part that is done. Since it's so wide that, you know, let's do something.